So we will discuss the venous drainage in particular and then its relation with respect to the venous drainage of the inferior extremity. So this is how it is initiated. We know how the supply comes from this arterial portion. The arteries, they divide and subdivide into smaller branches, and finally they divide into these pre-capillary arterioles. And these pre-capillary arterioles, they then divide and they form these capillaries, capillary bed. So that's how they supply the oxygen and the nutrients into the tissue. And on the another end, they are collected. This deoxygenated portion devoid of nutrients, they are collected at the venous end by these post capillary venules. So this is the initiation of the venule as the post capillary venules near the these capillary beds. We discuss now the different mechanism through which the venous blood finally returns to the heart. Now these are more important in case of the inferior extremity. We'll discuss how it is, but they are more important in case of the drainage of the venous blood from the inferior extremity. So first mechanism is this deep fascia. So deep fascia is the portion which resides over the muscle, and this thicker portion that lies just below the superficial venous system, when it contracts, when it stretches, then the venous blood or the venous column, it is compressed between this portion of the deep fascia and the skin and the superficial fascia. So this venous column is compressed in between, and the column of blood, it is propelled upwards. So first mechanism is the deep fascia. Then second mechanism is the intramuscular part. There are various portions in the body which have these venous plexus residing inside the muscles. So they are plexus which is inside the muscle tissue, and when these muscles, they contract, they again compress the venous portion, venous column, and thus this is shown here, this is the venous column, and when it contracts, this portion, it goes towards the column, propelled towards the heart when the muscle contracts. So because of that, this column of blood is propelled towards the heart. So they are this intramuscular pump residing in the soleus, in your calf, even in sole of the foot, there is an intramuscular plexus that is known as sole pump. So in the lower extremity there are two pumps, one the soleal pump in the calf, soleus muscle, there is a sole pump in the plantar aspect. And you have already may have seen, those who have dissected the hedonic portion, you may have seen this pterygoid plexus of it with relation to the pterygoid muscles, that also contains this venous plexus. So when the muscle contract, it squeezes the venous column or the vein, and thus the blood inside there is propelled. Then next mechanism is known as venae comitantes. Venae comitantes are paired vein that are positioned with respect to the midline placed artery. So this is the midline placed artery, and these are the two paired veins. Here this portion is showing the brachial artery, and there are two venae comitantes which are lying along with that. So when there is an arterial pulsation, when the artery pulsates, it distends, and because of that distension, it propels the nearby venae comitantes which are running with that. So because of that particular stretching, because of that particular compression, the column of blood residing in the vein is propelled towards the heart. So this is next mechanism, venae comitatus, which is running, which is the paired collateral vein running with the centrally placed heart or middle portion placed heart. The next is intrathoracic pumps. So there are two of them. One is the respiratory one, because when the intrathoracic pressure decreases, then the intra-abdominal pressure increases, and because of that it compresses the veins residing in the abdominal portion. So because of that, this column of blood is propelled towards that portion where there is a lesser pressure or less resistance. So that portion is, that column of blood is propelled from this abdominal portion towards the thoracic portion. That's how the blood from this venous, this vena cava, inferior vena cava, is propelled towards the heart, right atrial chamber. Even in case of superior vena cava, that is again this negative intrathoracic pressure, and even the gravity, it propels the column of blood it towards the heart. Next is, this is the respiratory, because of the respiratory activity. When you take this inspiration, this pressure inside the thoracic cavity decreases, and the pressure in the abdominal cavity decreases and propels the column of blood towards the heart. And second is the cardiac pump. So during the cardiac cycle, when there is a systole phase, the heart, it squeezes the blood out, and when there is a diastole, this is negative pressure which propels this blood towards the heart. It sucks the blood from this superior inferior vena cava towards the right atrial chamber. So this is the another mechanism. Intrathoracic pump. One is the respiratory one because of the respiratory movement, and second is the cardiac pump because of the cardiac cycle. Then next is this vasomotor supply, which is related to the autonomic nervous system. Basically, because of this sympathetic part of the nervous system, and one of the component is it causes vasoconstriction. So this vasoconstrictor portion, it also has a role in compressing the venous portion, venous stenosis. So that causes the contraction in the tunica media, especially of that large bore veins, and thus help to propel the blood. Because of that contraction, it helps to propel the blood towards the heart. We have discussed the blood is propelled towards the heart. And how it occurs? Because of the presence of these valves. So this is the another important mechanism. And this mere presence of the valve is the only mechanism which propels every column of blood towards the heart only, unidirectional flow. So when this column of blood, here it is shown the intramuscular pump. So when the column of blood which resides between these intramuscular portion, when it is propelled towards upward, it won't come down only because of these valves. So once the column of blood goes towards the heart, because of this unidirectional valve, they are unable to regurgitate backwards. So this is an important mechanism. And what is a valve? Valve is where this endothelial line portion which is projecting in. So it is made of endothelium, and the core is a thin amount of connective tissue, and only the base where it is attached to the wall, this portion is supported by the muscles, the tunica media. So that vital portion has the support, muscular support. Otherwise, the whole portion is made of endothelial portion. So this is the valve, which is very important in case of the venous stenosis. Next is gravity. So this is important in case of upper limb, drainage of the venous portion from the upper limb, from the head and neck, these portions. Because the column of blood from these portions, they may gravitate towards the heart because of only the gravitational force. So once these portions are like in the superior vena cava, they don't have any wall. So once the blood is there, they gravitate towards the heart. Or even if you raise your hand, then once the valve is open, that portion gravitates towards the heart. So this is the effect of the gravity. But in case of lower limb, the blood has to be propelled against the gravity. And that's why this venous drainage from the lower limb, it needs these assistance, these additional pump or pumping mechanism, either intramuscular pump or even vena comitantes, or even different type of fascia is there, because the fascia is, which is the deep fascia there, which is known as the facial artery, that is much thickened there. With respect to the upper limb, you can always compare. There is no such thing as this thickened deep fascia here in the upper limb. That is there only in the lower limb, which is the facial artery. So, to overcome this effect of the gravity, there are additional mechanisms in case of the lower limb. But what happens when one goes into those spaces where there is no gravity, like in the space, outer space? In that case, we have discussed they are negative intrathoracic pump, like the respiratory movement or the cardiac movement, cardiac pump. Because of that negative pressure is created inside this right atrial chamber, and that propels the blood, this venous blood, towards the heart. Even there is no effect of gravity, whenever there is no gravity. Now what happens when these valves, they are compromised, they are not functioning properly? In that case, there is a varicose. The veins, they become dilated, and these veins, they become thin wall. So here are two diagrams. One is showing this normal vein, and when the valve is closed, even when the blood, if the column of blood is going towards the flow, if the flow is going towards the opposite direction, then they are prevented by this closed valve. But in case of incompetency of this valve, they may regurgitate. And what happens when they regurgitate? They causes the dilatation of these veins and thinning of these veins, even tortuosity of these veins, which is evident in this diagram, this picture. Varicosity, dilated vein, easily seen through the skin, because here the skin is also exposed, dilated because of that. So these valves, they prevent the downward and outward flow against this closed portion. So here we can see how this mechanism of the varicosity works. In the diagram on the left, you can see this is the portion which shows the flow, normal flow through the veins. They flow towards the heart, and the valves, they permit that unidirectional flow of that. But in case of this impaired wall, incompetent wall, then the drainage is towards the heart, and even the blood, it regurgitates backwards also, downwards also. And because of that, the veins, they become dilated, and the adjacent portion, the portion above the wall and the portion below the wall, because of this increased pressure from the regurgitation, increased pressure, because when the blood goes towards the heart, some portion even comes back. Because of that, there is increased pressure in the wall in the vicinity. So the wall in the vicinity, it gets thinner, gets deformed, and it gets tortuous, and even the neighboring skin is bulging. because of this dilatation of the vein underneath, which is lining the superficial fascia. This is evident in the superficial venous system. So that's how this is shown. Dilated vein with the skin bulging, and even the hue of the vein is seen, clearly seen. Bluish hue of the vein is clearly seen. So in case of the lower limb, we have discussed this. We perform this test known as Trendelenburg test or Brody-Trendelenburg test. And this test is devised to show the competency of the valve in the superficial and deep veins in the patient with the varicose vein. And in case here, we tie this tourniquet, place at the upper thigh, above the knee and below the knee. And it checks the valvular incompetency of the perforator as well as the of this superficial vein, valve of the superficial vein also. This is how it is done. What we do first is to say the patient to just lie down and raise their leg, and then we tie this tourniquet. And tourniquet is placed at this upper portion where the femoral at the this portion of the saphenous opening on the upper portion of the thigh, then above the knee and below the knee. Three tourniquets are tied, and then we ask the patient to stand and we untie this tourniquet. And what happens here, if this initial wall, which is present at this saphenofemoral junction, ostial wall, if that is incompetent, then we see the filling of the blood from above. That shows this initial wall, which is draining the blood from the superficial venous portion, from the great saphenous vein towards the femoral vein, that is incompetent. So that shows the filling from the above. But if the filling is from below, not from the above, that shows the incompetency of these perforator, because this valve is closed. This valve is closed, which is present at the saphenofemoral junction. But these valves, which are joining the deeper venous system to the superficial venous system, they permit the regurgitation, and because of that, the blood passes from below. That shows the incompetency of these perforator. So rapid filling from the below, that indicates the incompetency of these perforating veins. And that's how we assess the valvular incompetency. And there is one more thing which is related to these venous portion, which is known as the deep venous thrombosis. The causes are multifactorial. There may be direct or indirect injury to the vein, like needle injury may be there, even trauma is there. So injury to the vein, surgery which is related to the venous portion, certain medication which causes this formation of the thrombus. So, and limited movement. So causes are these: injuries, surgery, medication, and limited movement. Sitting on a posture like on a chair for a long time, that may also cause it. So what happens initially, this shows, the upper diagram shows the normal flow of blood through a vein, but because of these conditions, there is an early formation of the clot and these colonies, and they form a thrombus, red thrombus. And when a part of this thrombus is dislodged and may go towards the lung, may go towards the brain, and this portion which is free to roam into the venous portion, through the venous portion, through the circulatory system, anywhere in the body, that portion, that embolus is dangerous. So, because it may even clog any portion, smaller portion of the blood, and if that portion, that vascular portion is end portion, then that may cause infarction. So this is the formation of embolus from this thrombosis. So now this is, nowadays we hear sitting is the new smoking. So avoid sitting for a longer time. Always take a walk if you sit for more than half an hour. So that's all about today's lecture.